like to welcome you here today to hear our what will surely be a very fascinating and important, urgent conversation. Dr. Jeff Halper is going to talk on globalizing Palestine, war against the people. And to introduce Jeff briefly, here is Dean Jane Fredericks.
Thank you. Good afternoon, students and faculty and colleagues. It's a pleasure to be here and an honor to introduce Dr. Halper. Dr. Halper was born in Minnesota and has been an activist, since the civil rights and the anti-Vietnam movements of the 1960s. He has a bachelor's degree in political science and also attended rabbinical school. Resistance to the war...
I'm supposed to tell all my secrets.
I didn't have enough paper for all of his secrets. So. Resistance to the war in Vietnam as a conscientious objector contributed to his decision to emigrate to Israel in 1973. Dr. Halper became a citizen of Israel, but during his mandatory service in the Israeli military, he refused to bear arms or to be stationed in the Palestinian territories. Dr. Halper earned a PhD in cultural anthropology from the University of Wisconsin and was later professor of anthropology and director as well at Friends World College, an institution guided by Quaker social ideals of community, spirituality, and stewardship. In 1997, Dr. Halper co-founded the Israeli Committee Against House Demolition, where he has been the director since then. Dr. Halper is also affiliated with the International Solidarity Movement and has spoken at numerous events sponsored by Students for Justice in Palestine. He frequently addresses church and collegiate office, audiences across the United States. Quote, "I am a leftist who is not ashamed of that," says Dr. Halper, emphasizing his belief that only if a just peace with the Palestinians is reached can the state of Israel survive. Dr. Halper has taken part in a number of direct actions designed to block the demolition of Palestinian homes. In 2000, he told an audience that, quote, "sitting under a bulldozer, what an image, to obstruct its path with a Palestinian is a bonding experience." He has been arrested at least 8 times for such activities. Dr. Halper is widely covered on Google, and I'm borrowing now a direct quote from one of the Google articles. A fellow Minnesotan, Bob Dylan, lyrics affected an entire generation as he asked, "How many ears must one man have before he can hear people cry?" Dr. Jeff Halper hears the cries, and not only hears, but continues brave and resolute action to bring about a more peaceful world. Dr. Halper.
Thank you very much. I'm not always introduced by the dean. Usually the dean is on the other side trying to pressure the Students for Justice in Palestine to cancel the event. So Worcester State is special from that point of view, really. So it's good to be here. There's a lot to say. I could give about 5 different lectures if we had about 6 hours. That have to do with Israel-Palestine that I've been involved with for all these years and the struggle for a just peace. But what I've been working on over the last couple of years, and I have a book, a new book called War Against the People that talks about that, is the global implications of the Israeli-Palestine conflict. In other words, if this was merely a spat There's my agent here. Anyway, just to prove that there really is a book. you know, rather than simply a spat between two peoples in some faraway corner of the world, in fact, one reason why the Israel-Palestine conflict is so important to everybody is that it really is a global conflict. I mean, it's happening in the middle of one of the most volatile regions of the world, the Middle East, where your own country is engaged in 5, 6, 7 wars. Nobody even knows how many wars are going on. It certainly affects your lives and the entire international system. And it also is important for everybody because it's a real challenge to human rights. you know, just as a little preface before we get into the book itself, to give it a little context, you know, this is Israel, which is on 78%. This is really one country between the Mediterranean and the Jordan River. Palestinians call it Palestine. Jews call it the Land of Israel. Religious people call it the Holy Land. Whatever you call it, it's one country. And there's two peoples that are claiming rights, national rights to that country, the Palestinians and the Israeli Jews. And because of all the conflict and so on, the idea was originally, what's called the two-state solution, was to divide the country between the two peoples, where the Jews, who are half the population but who are going to be the minority, the Israeli Jews, would get 78% of the country, and the Palestinian Arabs, who are the indigenous people, who used to own the whole country, would only get 22% of the land, which is the West Bank, East Jerusalem, which includes the Old City, and Gaza. And this, obviously, is a solution that is very pro-Israel. I mean, in 5 years from now, the Palestinians will be the majority in the country. Not to mention, of course, 5 million Palestinian refugees that live around the country, refugees from the 1948 war, that are, you know, and many of the refugees you hear about in coming into Europe from Syria and through Turkey are actually Palestinians. So, even if the Palestinians become the majority, Israel still remains on 78% of the country. So this whole idea is pretty much of a pro-Israel idea that was in fact accepted by the Palestinians 30 years ago. In 1988, the Palestinians accepted the two-state solution, which meant that they gave up political claim to 78% of their country, which a colonized people has never in history done, and said, we will recognize Israel and make peace with Israel for less than a quarter of the land that remains. Now, Israel has said no. Israel has said, no, we want the entire country. And what it's done over the years, this isn't what I'm going to get into today, but what it's done over the years is to what we call create facts on the ground that make the two-state solution impossible, that eliminate the two-state solution, and make Israeli control over the entire country permanent. Locking Palestinians into little islands, about 70 little islands called A and B of the West Bank, building these blue air and pink areas, our settlements. There's 200 Israeli settlements in the occupied territory, about 600,000 Israelis living there. And in the end, Israel wants to claim the entire country. Matter of fact, Israel denies there's an occupation from 1967, and Israel also never uses the word the West Bank. It calls it Judea and Samaria, the biblical terms, so that Israel is trying to make the entire country Israeli and to deny Palestinians their national rights. We have today one country in this part of the world, and it is an apartheid state. It's one people, the Israeli Jews, dominating over Palestinian Arabs, taking privileges of civil rights for themselves and denying them to the Palestinian population, so that this is obviously a problem of Israelis and Palestinians, but it's much greater than that. I mean, this talk is sponsored partly by the Center for Human Rights. Human rights, you know, that whole concept hasn't completely come to the United States the way it has to Europe and the rest of the world. But for oppressed peoples of the world, human rights is almost the only hope they have to get a fingerhold on some kind of inclusion, some kind of justice, some kind of participation, equality, something. Human rights means a lot, especially to oppressed peoples. And not just abroad, but to oppressed peoples in this country as well. So that if, you know, Israel could not maintain this occupation over the Palestinians for a month without American support. You know, the rest of the world, including Europe, sees this occupation and this whole conflict not as an Israeli occupation, but as an Israeli-American occupation. It's clear that it couldn't be maintained without the political and economic, financial support that the United States gives to Israel. In the UN, you have repeated votes in the UN on all kinds of issues, not only Israel-Palestine, arms control, landmines, human rights issues, where the vote in the UN is the United States, Israel, and Micronesia against the entire rest of the world. So the United States is becoming isolated on this. But what's more important is that, you know, we don't live in Hollywood. Good guys don't always win. And we're not necessarily the good guys either, which is something to keep in mind. But if, in fact, Israel, with the active help of the United States, President Obama last week signed a bill giving $40 billion in new arms to Israel over a 10-year period. You could use a little bit of $40 billion here in Worcester, I would think. You know, so that, and Biden, Vice President Biden is there now. And he criticized the Palestinians for the violence. Nothing about occupation, nothing about the fact that Israel is, in fact, the strong power that has eliminated this two-state solution completely. So the United States is complicit in this. But the more important piece, from my point of view, is that if, in fact, Israel wins with the help of the United States, if, in fact, Palestinian human rights are completely crushed and occupation wins, an entire people is actually imprisoned, what does that do? It sends a chilling message all over the world. It says to oppressed people everywhere, there is no such thing as human rights. They're on paper, they look good, we talk about it, but when it comes to the crunch, really to the test, do Palestinians have human rights? Can international law, of which Israel is in complete violation, Israel is in absolute violation of the Fourth Geneva Convention that prohibits the building of settlements, that prohibits extending your legal system into an occupied territory. It prohibits harming. As a matter of fact, under the Fourth Geneva Convention, the Palestinians are called a protected people. They're supposed to be protected by Israel because they have no government of their own. They have no army. They have no police force. They're completely vulnerable and dependent on the occupying power, which is Israel. And not only does international law require that of Israel, but international law requires every country in the world, including the United States, to ensure the well-being and protection of the Palestinian people and their rights. So the United States is in violation of international law. So this is really, in a sense, you know, I sometimes liken it to Lord of the Rings. This is like Mordor, you know? And those of us that are concerned about human rights, we're like the little hobbits. You know, we're human rights, human rights, human rights. And there's this huge Mordor of power and armies that are really challenging that. And Mordor could win. I mean, this isn't Lord of the Rings. And, you know, so that this conflict has implications globally and for the United States. and for issues like human rights that are genuinely global. So this is much more than simply some local conflict. There's 1,000 local conflicts all over the world, including here. But this is one that really demands our attention, because if we lose this, we lose much more than simply Palestinian rights. Now, one question you could ask, and I ask this in my book, is why didn't Israel accept the two-state solution 30 years ago? It's a pro-Israel solution. You get 78% of the country. You get peace. You get security. You get recognition by the entire Arab and Muslim worlds. You know, the Arab League unanimously accepted the two-state solution and the recognition of Israel. Why wouldn't Israel accept that? There's something going on here beyond peace and security. And that is, I would argue, that the occupied territory is really a laboratory for Israel, for testing and developing weapon systems, surveillance systems, all kinds of security systems, and weapons of control that are its main, not only its main export, so it has tremendous economic interest in keeping this laboratory going where it can experiment on Palestinians and then develop weapons and systems for export, but more than that, it's what gives Israel the political clout in the world that it has. Because if you're a military power, you know, in this world, you measure the importance of a country, unfortunately, by how many missiles it has, how many tanks it has, how many warships it has. And so if Israel can insert itself into the world, it's a country the size of New Jersey. So if it can insert itself into the world as a major military security power based on weaponry that it can produce, because unlike other countries, it has a laboratory of 4.5 million people that it can experiment on, that gives it a lot of political clout. And that leads into the second question that I ask. Not only why didn't Israel give up the occupied territory, because it's too valuable for Israel as a laboratory. But then the second question is, okay, but how does Israel get away with this? In other words, we're talking about violations of human rights, outright violations of international law, a brutal occupation that's on TV all the time. I mean, it's not in the jungles of the Congo or in the mountains of Afghanistan. This is in the Holy Land, no less, on the southern border of Europe, in the glare of every TV camera. This is probably the most documented conflict in history. There's nothing secret here. And we're talking now about 60, 70 years after the end of colonialism, when the idea that white people can rule over peoples of color and you can occupy people forever has long been gone in the bigger world, the question is, how does Israel actually get away with it? Not only does Israel get away with it, but its international standing improves all the time. You know, there's a club in the world that's called the OECD, which is the club of the most advanced economies in the world. And there's no club more exclusive than that. So Israel was elected a member of the OECD a couple years ago. Now, to get elected to the OECD is unanimous. It has to be unanimous. So here we're talking about 25 of the world's most advanced economies, including the United States. So you can assume these are 25 of the world's most educated populations, and probably the most liberal countries. Norway, Ireland, Sweden, countries for whom human rights are emblazoned on the flag. And all of these most advanced countries of the world voted unanimously to accept Israel as a member, even though the guidelines of the OECD say that countries have to conform to human rights conventions and international law. So how, why? What's going on here? In other words, what's the quid pro quo? How can you explain that? So, Henry Kissinger, our friend Henry, just to talk about human rights for a minute, used to say that countries don't have friends. They have interests. So I started to look for the interests here. What, in other words, again, what is Israel delivering to the governments of the world, the elites of the world, that can explain why they support its occupation policies and why they allow Israel to do what it does? And as I'm, of course, looking around for that elephant in the room, for that reason, you know, it becomes fairly clear that the answer is Israel's involvement and exporting of military security and police tactics and weaponry and so on. I mean, that because if you look up from the occupation, you know, Israel likes to present itself as this little country, this little Jewish boy in a tough neighborhood, right? And it always works on the victim thing. We're the victims. And it dovetails, of course, with the image of Jews. I mean, Jews are the ultimate victims in the world. So that's not a hard sell. We're Jewish, the Jews are the victims, everybody's against us, Arabs are terrorists, you know, anti-Semitism and the whole, you know, it's not hard to construct that kind of a thing. But if you look up at actually Israel's place in the world, a whole different picture begins to emerge. This little Israel, which is in fact little, turns out to be the fourth largest nuclear power in the world. So, I don't know if Palestinians have nuclear weapons, but Israel, now, nobody's going to catch up to the United States. You guys got 10,000 nuclear weapons. Israel has 200 to 300. It's roughly tied with France. But you could do some damage with 200 or 300 nuclear weapons and with multiple means of delivery. Israel is the fourth, fifth, sixth largest arms exporter in the world. Again, roughly tied with France. And this becomes very, on the one hand, this is good for Israel, the idea that it's a powerful country, an arms exporter. It's the go-to place if you want to fight wars. But on the other hand, Israel does not want its image to be one of a strong power. I mean, there's a whole internal contradiction here. Because if it's not the victim, and it's in fact a strong power, then you can hold it accountable. The advantage of being a victim is that a victim's a victim. You can't hold a victim accountable. So if I can be a powerful party, the fourth largest nuclear power in the world, and occupying power for almost 50 years over the Palestinians, and yet I'm the victim, it's perfect. I have all the power and no responsibility. You see? So this whole kind of a presentation of Israel as a strong power is very threatening to Israel. And in fact, this sets off pro-Israel advocates much more than anything else. The idea that somehow I'm presenting Israel as a strong, proactive power and not as a victim. So Israel has military relations with 130 countries that we know of. And this is part of what I call security politics. Security politics, you know, means that when you put the military, security, and policing that are really all one thing today, certainly since 9/11, they've come together as one package. You have the militarization of the police. That became clear in Ferguson, but everybody sees, and the Occupy movement that was really dismantled in this country in police, a military type police interventions. They weren't just police actions. And everybody knows that you have a Pentagon program called 1033 that in fact distributes surplus army equipment to police forces. So you have the militarization of the police, and you have, if you think about it, the policification of the military. Because militaries are being sent today not to win wars, but to do regime change, nation building, disciplining, all kinds of things, so that these things have become to merge into one package, the military, security, and policing, and they're a big package. Together, they account for an industry of $2.5 trillion a year. Well, that's a big industry. And the fact that we don't know much about it, I mean, I wrote a book about something I know nothing about, which is interesting to do. I don't know, I'm on the left, I'm an activist, I'm trying to make the world a better place, and I don't know anything about a $2.5 trillion a year industry. I mean, what do I know about missiles and military stuff and even policing stuff? That's a huge blind spot that I think we have to begin to fill in the left if we really want to begin to understand how the world works. But this is part of what's called security politics. When you put that much money and then the controlling technologies, the power of the military security policing into international relations, all of a sudden a whole different constellation emerges. Countries you'd expect to be enemies all of a sudden are allies on that other level. You know, security bypasses ideology. I'll give you just a perfect example. One example is Israel and Saudi Arabia. On the surface, there can't be two countries with more enmity than those two countries. One is a Zionist country that's really seen by the Arab world as oppressing Arabs and Muslims in general. And the other one is the sponsor of Al-Qaeda and ISIS and these radical religious anti-Western ideologies, supported by the West, but that's another story. You know, but if you look deeper than that, it turns out that Israel and Saudi Arabia have many common interests. They both support the Sunnis in the Muslim world in the war against the Shias. Israel is on record as saying, we are on the side of the Sunnis. And there's weird bedfellows here. You know, in the civil war that's going on in Syria, Israel has a hospital in the Golan Heights, which is in Israel occupies part of Syria for the last 50 years. It's another occupation called the Golan Heights that borders here on Syria. And Israel has a hospital where it treats Al-Qaeda fighters. Al-Qaeda fighters that are fighting in Syria, the al-Nusra. Why? Because Israel really, I mean, it has all kinds of problems, but Israel's on their side in the sense that they're Sunnis. And they're fighting Hezbollah, that are Shiites from Lebanon, and anybody that fights Shias are on the side of Israel, de facto at least. And it's very interesting, ISIS, Daesh, is Sunni. Right? And if you think about it, they never threaten Israel. You know, so there's a whole really interesting thing going on here. So then it turns out that Israel and Saudi Arabia are allies in terms of supporting the Sunnis, which means, of course, they're allies against Iran. For both of them, Iran is a huge preoccupation. And there could easily be a situation where they attack Iran together. As a matter of fact, Israel and Saudi Arabia together are involved in the fighting in southern Yemen. So when you stick security politics in, new kinds of bedfellows emerge. The other common thing, of course, is both Israel and Saudi Arabia are against the Arab Spring. They're against democracy, democratic movements emerging, which is partly why the United States supports Israel and Saudi Arabia and Egypt. The United States sent equipment to Mubarak to fight the Arab Spring. Hillary Clinton, when she was Secretary of State, was against the Arab Spring. Democracy, I mean, you're saying you're exporting democracy all over the world and getting in wars with people that don't want democracy. And then when a people like the Egyptian people or the Palestinians say, we'd like a little democracy, please, The answer is to support their militaries. And this puts Israel, the United States, Saudi Arabia on the side of the Sunnis and the dictatorships, for whatever that means. So that once, and now, how is that expressed partly? In 2002, the entire Arab League presented what's called the Arab Peace Initiative that said to Israel, if you give up the occupied territories, we'll not only make peace with you, we'll integrate you into the region. And this initiative was Saudi formulated. So here's the most extreme Islamic country in the world that's on the side of Israel. That would not have happened if Israel didn't have the military clout that it has. The fact that Israel has that power is what makes it an ally. Nothing ideological. And you can replicate that all over the world. I'll give you one other example, which is amazing. Israel is seen as an ally of the United States. Right? If you go to your member of Congress, then try it. I promise you, this is what's going to happen. And you say, why are you supporting Israel in the uncritical, absolute way you are? The answer is going to be because Israel is our most loyal ally in the Middle East. We love Israel. Israel loves the United States. We share moral values. Netanyahu is invited to Congress every 3 weeks. You know, well, then you begin to look at this map of military security policing, and you find out that, hey, Israel is the number two arms supplier to China. Whoa! China is the arch rival today of the United States. The United States is moving the entire Sixth Fleet into the South Pacific to try to contain China. It has territorial claims on a lot of Southeast Asia. The economy, of course, is threatening the United States. This is the greatest rival of the United States, and all of a sudden its most loyal ally is its number two arms supplier. And you know who number one is? Russia. So there's a whole Cold War beginning between the United States and Russia. Trump, our friend Trump, was criticized by all the other Republican candidates because he kind of said a good word about Putin. There's a whole Cold War beginning again with the Russians, and the Russians and the Israelis are supplying arms to the largest rival of the United States. That's security politics at work. You don't have friends, you have interests. And you've got, so that if you just, I'm not going to go country by country, there's 194 of them, but if you went country by country, you could find the quid pro quo in every country. Why the United States supports Israel and is giving $40 billion, and Israel does play a role in the American defense industry, especially in high-tech weapons components, and Europe as well, where Israel's developing the Watchkeeper drone, which is the new European drone. Why Israel gets the support of the BRICS countries, these countries you've been talking about that rival the United States in Europe, Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa, Mexico, Indonesia, Turkey, Nigeria. These countries, almost to a country, have always been pro-Palestinian. Now they've done a 180-degree turn, and they support Israel internationally. Why? Again, I would say there's a quid pro quo here. In terms of supplying the elites and the governments with these technologies of control. And then you've got the whole global south. Israel's involved in the global south, in countries the United States has never heard of. Israel is training the police and security forces in Equatorial Guinea, which is considered to be the worst dictatorship in Africa. So it goes from Washington down to Equatorial Guinea, including actually drug cartels and mafias. Any non-state actors that have power are in this kind of a thing. So the quid pro quo, why you support Israel, you know, becomes kind of straightforward. But there's another dimension that I bring in as well, and that is capitalism. We live in a world capitalist system. We don't feel it all the time because it's a sea we swim in. So it's invisible. You know, there's a story about two fish that meet. And one fish says to the other one, "How's the water?" And the other fish says, "What water?" Or, "What's water?" So that people are feeling that they're in a system that's not working very well. You have the Occupy movement. You've gotten the idea of the 99% and the 1%, which is actually true. Oxfam came out with a report 3 weeks ago that 1% of the world's population owns 50% of the world's resources. We know climate change. Naomi Klein's latest book, Climate Change and Capitalism. So we know that it's becoming more and more unsustainable. And as this system becomes more unsustainable, as it enters more and more into crisis, and it needs to enforce its hegemony. Capitalism always worked when I was young, when I was your age. Capitalism was expanding. It was fun. You could be a hippie. You could be a hippie. You know, we talked about the revolution in the 60s. And the revolution could be crystals, could be love, like Woodstock. It could be drugs, like Haight-Ashbury. Could be political. It was very general because we were living in a happy capitalist system, and it was very trendy to be anti-capitalist, but we were all living it very well, much more than you guys are, that don't have the security that we did. So capitalism had a happy face, and Ronald McDonald and MTV and all our toys and Hollywood and all of that. Today, as it gets into crisis, and as there's more resistance, and more people are being excluded, two-thirds of humanity are defined by corporations as surplus. Surplus humanity. Disposable humanity. Including not a few people in the United States. The global south is also inside the global north. So that as that system becomes more repressive and more exclusive and more, it has to enforce its hegemony. And that's where Israel comes into the picture. Because it's interesting, and this is something I discovered, maybe I'll just say a couple more words and then how long should I?
Well, let's leave time.
Yeah, no, I want to leave time.
Oh, okay. So maybe 5 more minutes?
Okay, 5 more minutes. So, I'm going to talk fast. Try to talk fast. So what's interesting, if you look at the way wars are today, when we think about war, we think about war. War is armies, jet airplanes, battleships, missiles, and so on. But the last real war in that sense was World War II, maybe Korea. You don't have that kind of war anymore. So the wars at the Pentagon is geared to fight. A war against the Soviet Union just isn't going to happen. So that wars today, this is what I'm saying, as capitalism begins to close down and become more repressive, and it's the world system. There's nowhere in the world that's outside of capitalism anymore. That's the system. And as it becomes more repressive and more unequal and so on, its fight is beginning. Now, what kind of wars are it fighting? Well, it's not fighting armies anymore. It's fighting the people. And generals call war today war amongst the people. Counterinsurgency, asymmetrical wars, hybrid wars, they call them sometimes. These kinds of wars against urban warfare. Everything you read about in the news, what the United States is engaged in, basically. These are wars. Now, generals say amongst the people, because generals try not to be political. But it's obvious that the people aren't just there. They're wars against the people. That's the title of my book. These are wars against the people. People, either poor people sitting on top of valuable minerals and resources that we want. After the first Gulf War, I mean, you know, you entered into the war in Iraq, you know, because of weapons of mass destruction that didn't exist. It's clear there was a mineral agenda and not really security. And that was more upfront in the first Iraq War. The first Iraq War, there was a bumper sticker on cars in the United States. How did our oil get under their sand? That was what it was all about. So wars against the people are either people sitting atop valuable resources. For example, the equator, roughly a belt around the equator, is where some of the world's most valuable resources are, but where some of the world's poorest people are. So to remove them, to exclude them, to categorize them as surplus humanity, obviously arouses resistance. People don't get excluded and oppressed and passively. And you get those kinds of wars. Those kinds of wars are called hybrid wars, again, asymmetrical conflicts, counterinsurgency, the kind of wars that we're fighting today. Inside our societies, we're fighting also wars against the people, securocratic wars, wars to control and discipline the populations here at home. I just flew here from Louisville, Kentucky. I was an hour in the airport. I must have heard the word security 50 times. It's still ringing in my ears. You see, the United States is turning from a democracy into what's known as a security state, where security trumps everything and compromises democratic protections. You see it today in the fight between the FBI and Apple over that phone. And I guarantee you the majority of the American people is going to side with the FBI. Because security trumps privacy, democracy, all these things that were so important for Americans. So you're beginning to become a security state like France, that's living now under a state of emergency, and like Israel. Israel has always been a security state. So that finds expression in the militarization of the police. You know, and even the language. Look, when we talk about the war on drugs, war on crime, take domestic issues and you militarize the language, the metaphors. You know, Homeland Security, for the first time, puts together the military policing and security. Homeland Security is one of the largest government departments today. It employs more than 700,000 people in Homeland Security. And the United States, with the Patriot Act, is really today living under a state of emergency that's permanent. So that these are what are called securocratic wars against the people. Because security is not just a technical thing. I take off my shoes and my belt and I go through the airport. Security is a political concept. Who's being secured? And why, and whose interests are behind it. And even the language, whose interests is the language serving? So this all becomes political. What I do in the book, I'm working with some other people, and I'm going to finish in a sec, working with some other researchers that say, let's change the language. The word security closes down any kind of questioning. Of course I want to be secure. And the job of my government is to help me be secure, and there's no problem here. I take off my shoes, and I discipline myself. I was in a line in the airport, in Ben Gurion Airport in Israel. In Israel, you don't take off your shoes or your belt, like in Europe. You don't do that stuff. And in many cases, you don't take your computer out of the bag, because in the 21st century, there's no reason to take your computer out of the bag. That's simply another trick to discipline you. And there's an American couple in front of me in line that are yelling at the Israeli security officials that they want to take off their shoes. How am I going to be safe on the airplane if I don't take off my shoes? We're self-disciplining ourselves and buying into this. So language becomes important. What if instead of security, we use the term pacification? Okay, you want to be secure. You want to be pacified? And that raises all kinds of critical questions. Who's pacifying me? Why are they pacifying me? How are they pacifying me? So all this becomes relevant, and just to take it back for 2 minutes, I promise, this becomes the niche that Israel fills. Because Israel has much more experience in wars against the people. It's been fighting the Palestinian people for 100 years than the United States does. It's had only episodic wars against the people and hasn't done very well. And it hasn't done very well because your weapons are weapons of this kind of warfare that are not suitable for this kind of warfare. You don't fight urban warfare with F-35s. You don't have the weaponry to fight urban warfare that Israel has, and that's one reason why Israel is training the American police and the American army and so on. What I want to do, just to take one more minute, I promise, I'm not going to talk about it, but what I try to do in the book is there's a lot of stuff to talk about, also to expose us to the technologies of control. Because most of us, I won't take a hand poll today, but most of us in the left come from the social sciences or the humanities, not from the hard sciences. We don't know what these mad scientists are cooking up in their labs with a billion-dollar grant from the Pentagon. And I'm telling you, Tom Cruise movies are old-fashioned. There's technologies today, nano-weaponry, genetic weaponry, robotics, weaponry in outer space, surveillance, drone technologies, that sound to us like science fiction. And I try to expose that, and these are actually, a lot of them are weapons of repression. They're not weapons of warfare. They're weapons to be used against people. I'm not going to get into aerial. Drones are one example. Why is Israel the champion in drones and not the United States? Because these are weapons that are used against the people that don't have air forces. The United States never wanted drones because you can shoot them down in a conventional war. So your concept of war determines your weapons. Stations like these, weapon stations around Gaza, they're not remote control. You have here soldiers sitting in Las Vegas that run drones in Afghanistan to decide who to shoot. These are systems in which they decide who to shoot. Systems do by algorithms. Nanotechnologies, including DNA targeting, nanoweaponry, and I'm going to leave you with one. You know, here's a drone with a head of poison and eyes of cameras. And here's sort of one of the ultimate weapons. How's this for a weapon? You can weaponize insects today. So what I'm saying is the technologies of control and security are such that if we don't understand them and develop strategies of resistance, we are going to be passive. I'll leave it at that.
Okay. Questions, starting with students, and I would also like you guys to try to keep your questions relatively short to give as many people a chance. I'm going to start with just one question, breaking the student rule, I guess. But if you could speak briefly about the civil society and peace movement in Israel, because I think there's a wide perception in the U.S. that any critique of Israeli policy is anti-Israeli, anti-Semitic. And if you could speak to your position within that field, and maybe your organization briefly.
All right. Well, I'm the head of a group called the Israeli Committee Against House Demolitions. Israel has demolished 47,000 Palestinian homes in the occupied territory since 1967, not for security reasons. They're not homes of terrorists. That's what Israel would like you to believe. But for other reasons, I'm not going to get into. Reasons of control and taking the land and displacing the people. So, you know, as Israelis, we criticize Israeli policy. And I guess just to answer your question really quickly, you know, one reason why the Jewish community in the United States is so defensive and so seemingly, I think there's a lot of cracks. I mean, the largest growing Jewish organization in the country is the Jewish Voice for Peace. That speaks very clearly about ending the occupation. And for BDS, Boycotts, Divestment, Sanctions, which is a movement around that. So, and a lot of Jews, I have secret meetings with rabbis all the time in Starbucks by the highways. They can't get me in their synagogues. There are a lot of cracks in the Jewish community. But I think that the big reason why Jews are very defensive on this is because they're afraid that criticism of Israel will spill out and become criticism of Jews or become anti-Semitism. In other words, if people don't know how to differentiate between Israeli policies and Jews in general. And I can understand that fear. The problem is that it's Israel that's actually creating that confusion and that brewing on purpose. So when Netanyahu, our prime minister, gets up in the UN or gets up in Congress and says, I speak for the Jewish people. What I did in Gaza, I did in the name of the Jewish people. The Jews here should say, hey, wait a minute, we didn't vote for you. You don't speak for us. If they would do that, they might say, we love Israel, but you don't represent us. Don't make me complicit in the attack on Gaza. If they would do that, then you could say that that separation really exists. If they don't, and they don't do that, the organized Jewish community does not say that. And so they're complicit. They go along with the Israeli attempt to mix, to present its policies against Palestinians as what all Jews want to do. So I think the Jewish community here has a responsibility to disassociate itself from those policies.
Yeah. Oh, sorry, student.
Are you
a student?
He is, actually.
I think most of us are here because we care about human and civil rights for all.
I hope all of us are here for that.
I feel that Israel also protects legal rights and serves all the wounded in their hospitals. And I'm a little disappointed in the seems like one-sided critical view of Israel by a rabbi and a Quaker that seems to...
I'm neither one.
Okay, but you seem to be ignoring the fact that Israel was founded by refugees who had no place to settle and except in that hostile environment, and then they had to specialize in defending themselves for survival. Mm-hmm. And the U.S. and most capitalist countries sell arms to anyone who will buy them, openly or through third parties. So I'd just like to ask, how do we end the occupation? Where do you expect Jews to go?
Thank you very much.
Well, that's a little question that I can answer briefly. that's all part of the narrative. Israel's this whole country, and we're all refugees, and the Arabs are the bad guys, and they attacked us, and we're defending ourselves. It's not the story. And I'm not going to get into the story. That's not what we can talk about today. The point I'm making is that, I'm an Israeli. I live there. I have children there. I have grandchildren there. So obviously, I care about the country. But that's why I'm saying, because Israel is the strong party, it's not the victim. There's no balance here. There's no symmetry. There's no both sides. Israel is the occupying power. Israel's one of the largest militaries in the world. Israel's been occupying the Palestinian lands for 50 years. It carries the lion's share of responsibility. And what Israel has done deliberately and consciously is eliminate this two-state solution by its settlements. It didn't build 200 settlements for security to defend itself. It's a proactive claim to the country. It didn't demolish 47,000 homes in order to protect itself. So that what's happened is by eliminating the two-state solution, Israel has created an apartheid regime. We have a regime today of Jews over Palestinians, the Jews have become the Afrikaners of the world, which is very chilling for me, since human rights and civil rights define Judaism, especially in this country. So my answer, my solution is, what I'm trying to talk about, is to say, okay, Israel, you created one state. You, Israel, eliminated the two-state solution. Don't blame the Arabs for that. But that one state that we accept cannot be an apartheid state. It has to be a democratic state of equal rights for all its citizens, which shouldn't be such a revolutionary idea in the United States, a democracy. And Israel has created a situation in which Israel cannot be a Jewish state anymore. You can't have it both ways. You can't be a Jewish state and then take all the lands of the Palestinians and 4.5 million Palestinians and not give them equal rights. You can't do both. You can either have a Jewish state, sort of, and that means a two-state solution that Israel eliminated, or you can have one state in the land of Israel, but then it can't be Jewish. And that's an Israeli decision, and they went that way. Israel thinks it can get away with apartheid. It can have its cake and eat it too. It can have the whole country and control and not give Palestinians their rights. No. We and Jews should be at the forefront to say no. We are not going to be the new Afrikaners. And therefore, the only way out is to transform the country into a democratic state in which I'll remain, my children and grandchildren will remain there as Israeli Jews. We'll continue to speak Hebrew. We'll still have a Hebrew university. But we'll live like Canada that has Francophiles and Anglophiles. We'll live in one democratic state. And we'll have our national communities as well.
All right, just like to introduce myself. My name is Michael David Laurie, and the second. First of all, I want to thank you for coming out here. I really do appreciate a round of applause from everybody.
I did not pay him for that. He's not
it really does take a lot for an Israeli native to speak out against their own country, as it does any national. But I just want to point out, and this goes along...
That was a butt when they say nice things.
A typical Republican. So basically, I want to point out before I get to my line of questioning, the incredible gall, as well as misdirection, in calling and comparing Israel to Mordor. Mordor was something that wanted to destroy all mankind and even destroy themselves. Mm. So my line of questioning... sorry, I took my notes on my phone. I do apologize.
All right. But, just don't SMS as you're asking.
So basically, as an all-knowing critic, somebody that's written books such as yourself, Israel has its first priority as its safety. As we all know. Safety.
No.
The priority...
No, its priority is to take the entire country.
Well, as a...
Its safety is guaranteed by the fact that it's the fourth largest nuclear power in the world.
Well, I would argue differently. The very basis of a country is to protect its people and to ensure its own national security. So, as we've seen in the past, as things such as Operation Protective Eagle, as well as the Gaza War from 2008 to 2009, previously to the Gaza Strip War, there were 3,287 rockets landing in Israel in the year 2008.
Do you have a question? Because
yes, no, I am.
Great.
So,
thank you.
How, as we've seen in 2009, after the Gaza War, those rocket attacks went down to 700. Mm-hmm. If there is such a clear advantage to invading and occupying and protecting their own citizens through invasion and through occupation, how else are they supposed to protect their citizens?
Thank you.
My answer would be make peace. And I'm not saying that as a slogan. I'm not saying that as a slogan. In 1988, in Algiers, publicly, the Palestine National Liberation Organization accepted the two-state solution. They said, we will make peace with Israel, and this was backed by the entire Arab world. We will make peace with Israel. You'll get peace, you'll get security, you'll get integrated into the region. We'll accept you into the Arab League if you give up the occupied territories and let the Palestinians establish a state on 22% of the land. The West Bank, East Jerusalem, and Gaza. If you do that, we will, and this is before Oslo, it's before intifadas, all, we could have avoided all of that. Can you imagine, I'm not saying this isn't the cause of all the conflicts in the Middle East, but can you imagine if this conflict, with the billions of, the conflict is, and the billions of dollars of arms, had been resolved 30 years ago, how that might have impacted on the Middle East today? Maybe we wouldn't be where we are today if that had been done. The Palestinians extended to Israel a more than generous offer. You take 78% of our country. They didn't give up claim to Palestine. We cede 78% of our country to our occupiers, to our colonizers. Take it. It's yours. It's Israel. We accept it. We recognize it. Give us 22% and we'll all make peace with you. And Israel said no. So where's the responsibility for the safety of your citizens? And of course, what do you want? 50 years later, 30 years later from 88, the people of Gaza have no water to drink. They're drowning in sewage. They can't fish. They're living under occupation. What do you want them to do? Just sit there? You don't think you would throw rockets? You'd throw rockets 10 minutes after you lived in that kind of a situation. It's very easy to be judgmental sitting in Worcester. Try living in Gaza for a few years. So what I'm saying is, I agree with you. I agree with you that Israel has a responsibility to the safety of its people. And the only way to guarantee that is to resolve the conflict, which it could have done multiple times. Last word, until today, this minute, the agenda of the PL, of the of Palestinian Authority, of Abu Mazen, is the two-state solution. It's gone, Israel, but they still want a two-state solution. It's still on the table. So you have to hold Israel accountable, don't you think? Yeah, Israel has to be held accountable for what it's doing. It's not the victim. That's what I'm trying to say.
The Hamas terrorist organization is accountable too, and the only way to deal with
you say it's a terrorist organization.
Well, it is.
They think it's a resistance organization. I think the United States is a terrorist organization.
I've got three more questions lined up for you.
Okay.
All right. You're there, and they're back there. Go ahead.
I'm going to change the direction and keep this a simple question for you.
Okay.
First of all, I completely 100% agree with you that capitalism is completely the problem with this issue. My question now is, what's the solution?
Okay.
Aha.
Well, that's, yeah, right. A brief question and... Well, what I'm doing, I tell you, the solution is... And I'm not going to get into it because we really just have a minute. What we have to do is, first of all, we have to formulate what the alternative is to capitalism. I think, you know, socialism might be one direction, but, you know, beyond that, you know, I think the Occupy movement here really resonated with people. People said, yeah, you know, it's true. There were millions of people who went out. Where it floundered was when it said, people said, okay, we're against capitalism, or capitalism's not working, or whatever. What do you suggest? And that's where we didn't have an answer. And you can get people to be understand that the situation they're in now is problematic, but unless you give them somewhere to go, they're not going to go there. That's what we have to do. We have to get together with David Harvey, and maybe Chomsky, and Naomi Klein, and other people, and we have to formulate what would be what I call, as an alternative to the hegemony of capital, what I call a human-centric hegemony, or a life-centric hegemony, where people and life comes first. What does that mean, economically, politically, and so on? And we haven't done that yet. Once we do that, then we have to develop strategies of how do we resist capitalism, because the capitalists aren't going to, the ruling class is not going to give up easily. And then what are we going to replace it with? And one project that I'm working on now is called the People Yes Network. It comes off a poem by the American poet Carl Sandburg called The People Yes. And that is that we don't have today a global, not just a global strategy, a global organization. One of the most destructive bumper stickers in the United States, I think, was one that many of you know. think global, act local.
Yeah.
That's terrible. What about acting globally? I mean, the only ones that act globally are corporations and militaries. So we have to think global, act global, and also act locally, of course. So what I'm trying to do is that, with some other activists, is to develop a kind of an infrastructure, a network in which groups all over the world can cooperate, communicate, strategize, share analyses, share campaigns, and begin to develop global strategies. Because all these local things we're fighting are local. They're not the root canal work. If you want to solve climate change, you don't go recycle your plastic bottles in Worcester. You have to go big and global. And that's what we're not built for today. So I think the analysis, the alternative, the organization, and the campaigning are where we have to go, which is a pretty big order.
Indeed. Thank you. Question here?
Yes. Hello. My name is Tiara. A professor of mine, who's actually in the room right now, recently challenged me to think process over property, or to look at them as two separate things. One of the most important things I think I pulled out of this lecture today deals with asymmetry. And in your example with the fish, the two fish swimming in water,
mm-hmm.
we always focus on the fish who doesn't know what the water is, but not the fish who asks the question of how's the swimming today. So when you're talking about this state of emergency, and you start, a state of emergency is something that's supposed to be temporary.
That's right.
However, as time passes, it becomes something that's normal, something that's just become an everyday part of your life, something that's permanent. When that happens, who then, how do you refigure that asymmetry? So the person says, what's a state of emergency? Not even knowing that that's exactly the life they're existing in. How, how do you overpower exclusion? Is it inclusion by exposition, exposing what it is about the asymmetry? Or I feel like that's more where the focus needs to be, not on the history or what things have happened in the past. It's how do these, how does everything work in relation to another? How
that's
do all of these forces operate together?
No, that's really great. That's a really great question and comments. And there's a lot of ways to respond to that. I guess one thing is, that's always concerned me, is how do you generate critical thinking in people? That's sort of where you have to sort of start. And, you know, again, if you look, I'm not trying to be conspiratorial. I hate conspiracy theory and all that stuff. But if you look at the logic of the capitalist system, its educational system is obviously geared towards preparing people for the job market. It's not going to prepare people to be critical and overthrow the system. And so the problem is, and you have professors, and you have classes, you have institutes within that that are, the problem is how do we get people to figure this out, to be critical? And if that, if we can begin to generate that, those kinds of people, then what I'm talking about begins to be more clear. I consider myself critical. I wrote a book, my last book, the first chapter was The Making of a Critical Israeli. But I have to say, if I look back at it, it wasn't intentional. It was accidental. I had a certain teacher. Really, it's true. Teachers play a tremendous... If you're lucky to have a teacher, or you have an experience. I mean, I went to Kenya to do research, in Ethiopia. You know, I had experience. I had certain experiences that led me to be critical. But it was very ad hoc. The question is, how do we build into the system something where everybody can become critical and take control of their lives? And then I think this stuff becomes much less threatening and much less surprising than it would otherwise.
One more question, and
okay.
I think
and I'll leave the bottom line to my friend here.
Thank you so much for
coming to talk about that. But I'm going to ask you for a question.
Yes.
Okay.
All right. Yep. So my question is, you talked a lot about Israel dealing with the Palestinians, but what about the Israeli state repression of its own people, particularly Israelis of color and also poor Israelis and left-wing activists?
Ooh, good question.
That's a great question. And women and everything. You can keep going. Ethiopian Jews, certainly. That's the cost you pay. If you're dealing with repression, you don't have to, first of all, it has to be kind of across the board. You don't have time to, you know, we call ourselves abroad the only democracy in the Middle East. At home, we call ourselves a Jewish democracy. So we're trying to get privilege one group over another. Israeli Jews over even other Israeli citizens. So for example, non-Jewish Israelis, that are almost 30% of the population, are forbidden to live on 94% of the land of the country that's reserved for Jews. Well, once you start that kind of privileging, then you can't stop it. Then, of course, that 94%, well, the best part should be for the middle-class people. They happen to be the Ashkenazi white people. And then the Mizrahi Jews of color get pushed into the working classes and into the marginal, where they come in contact with the Arab population that's oppressed. And then you're pitting poor Israeli Jews who are Mizrahim against... So you have walls, for example, in Ramleh between poor Israeli Jewish communities and poor Palestinian communities, all citizens of Israel. And then it keeps going down. You simply don't have the space and the structure to deal with equality and these kinds of issues if the whole system is based on repressing one people. And that's, I think, the dilemma that Israel's in.
That's right.
So it's true. It's not only not protecting its population, but it's perpetuating inequalities within its society, because that's what conflict does. So, thank you very much.
Thank you all very much, Dr. Halper, certainly asked us question the answer before last, to think critically, and asked us as educators to encourage critical thinking. He's given me a lot to think about this, and thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.